Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Math Homework Hotline. I'm Tammy Derry.
And I'm Hannah, everybody.
And we're glad you're watching our show this evening because our show is really designed just for you to help you with your math homework. Our phone lines are open right now, so you can go ahead and give our teachers a call and they will help you with those math questions you have tonight. That number's along the bottom of your screen. You can find us at 813-840-7260. So keep us busy tonight. And don't forget, we are streaming live, so if you happen to walk away from your television, you can take us along on a tablet or a phone and you can find us at mhh.mysdhc.org. So don't forget about that. We are on the go with you. And don't forget that if you would like a problem worked out on the TV and you can see it, or while you're walking with your tablet, Hannah and I will be happy to work out a question and you can watch us work it out on your tablet or television. So go ahead and ask for your problem to be put on air. We would love to do that for you. And tonight is a very special night because we have a phenomenal topic for you. It's right in line with some of the things that you've been working on in your classes. Let's take a look at it. Yeah. Tonight's topic is all about bivariate data. We'll also talk about some other things related to data so that it all kind of makes sense. We'll look at scatter plots. We'll talk about the line of best fit. And if you are even in our algebra classes and you're watching, stay tuned tonight for the show because some of this will really help you. I know Hannah's got some great problems planned. We'll also take a look at some two-way table work and we will hopefully get you ready for all the data stuff you're going to be doing in your math classes. All right, and tonight is also a really great show. In addition to the challenge question, which I'm going to tell Hannah to take a look at in a minute, we have a special evening planned for you. So you could win lots of great things. You could be in a drawing for a McDonald's gift cards. We'll be randomly selecting some callers to win those. That's going to be fun. Hannah, I know you would enjoy that, but you're not eligible. Hannah, sorry.
Unfortunately.
But we also have our Math Homework Hotline t-shirts. This is the Do the Math shirt on the front, and on the back is our Math Homework Hotline logo. And I do want to give a quick shout out. I don't know if the student will be watching, but I did go out to Martinez Middle School last week and awarded the Kindle to the winner. So we do go out to the school sites. I went out there to Martinez and gave the student in Mr. Moskowitz's class the Kindle. And you know what, Hannah? This was really awesome. When I got there, I kind of thought I knew who the student was, even though I hadn't met him yet. And the reason why is because he was a student in the class wearing the, ready, Do the Math shirt. So congratulations again to our student out at Martinez Middle School for winning the last Kindle. And speaking of that, guess what? In addition to possibly winning those McDonald's gift cards, Hannah, the t-shirts, your name will also go in the drawing for our last Kindle drawing, which I believe is going to happen next week.
Yes.
So if you are watching, keep calling in with those math questions so you can get in for some of this great stuff tonight. All right, speaking of great stuff, it is time to head on over to Hannah to take a look at that challenge question.
Yes, everybody, we're going to take a quick look at the challenge question, which I tell you in front. It does not relate to tonight's theme as usual, just for change, because tonight's theme is kind of hard to put a question of or about on the screen. You would not have enough time to copy those charts and data and stuff like that. So please understand why I had to go with a different topic. But you're going to like what you're going to see. Let's take a look at it. It's about a house that the owner of the house went ahead and built it as a square pyramid, believe it or not. I saw this house myself. It is in Illinois, here in the United States, and I visited it long ago in 1988, I believe, or 1989. I was on a tour bus, and the bus driver and the guide of that tour pointed at that house from a distance and told us how the owner built it in that shape because he loved the pyramids and he's fond of the great pyramids in Egypt. The amazing thing is, in addition to the shape of the house, this is a real house. They live in it for real, okay? And they open it for tourism twice a week. You can even Google it and take a look at it yourself. Just Google the gold pyramid or the pyramid house. I went pyramid house and it came right away. However, this is the real picture of it, except for I did some stretches just to make it fit with the picture and the writing on the screen. But other than that, it is the real picture. Now, the owner of this house had covered it with a layer of gold, believe it or not, 24 karat gold. This is real stuff, okay? This is a real story. And you can find out yourself. I assumed some dimensions for it, so please don't take it as real dimensions, but I just figured out that would work for our estimation of the volume. Here it reads as follows. It says, find the volume of the square pyramid house below, given that the length of the side of the base is 80 feet and the height is 50 feet. One more time. Take those two pieces here. The length of the side of the base is 80 feet or 80 foot, and the height equals 50 feet or 50 foot. All right, everybody? What are we asking you to do? Find the volume. Say the owner wanted to air condition this. What kind of machine, how big, how small the AC machine would be, that will be determined based on the volume. Big volume would demand big machine. Small volume would demand smaller machine, or bigger, of course, but it will be okay to have a smaller machine for a smaller size. So we want you to work as the AC guy, and we want you to find out the volume of this pyramid house. Take a look at it, study it, take a shot of it, and work according to your pace, and call us. The first one to call us with the right answer, you know the drill, will be announced as our challenge question winner for tonight, and that could be you. All right? We'll wait for your call. We're going to pass it on to Miss Deary for the first time. And here we go. Tammy, it's all with you.
All right. Thanks, Hannah. And actually, I get the pleasure tonight of talking to a caller right away. So let's see if we have Deborah on the line. Deborah, are you with me?
Yes.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
Good. I'm glad you called in tonight. I see you're still working on integers.
Yeah.
Okay. Because the last time you called, and I think it was a couple weeks ago because we were off air for a little while, you were working on just the beginnings of integers. And the problem they sent in for me to work with you tonight looks like you have to do some operations. So let's go ahead and take a look at it together. And I'm going to let you be the teacher tonight and tell me a little bit about what you might know about how you would think about this problem. What would you think about in your mind first? Do you remember, has Ms. Fry talked to you about order of operations?
Yes.
Okay, so let's talk through those so the audience watching will remember it along beside you. So do you know what order you should go in? Okay, I'm going to write it down. Tell me if this looks right. All right, how did I do?
Good.
Except I started to put subtraction before addition, but it would work either way. Okay, so we have that. Now, what does the P stand for?
Parentheses.
Okay, I'm going to put parentheses like that. Can you see that on your TV?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's what the P stood for. The E stands for what?
Exponents.
And what does the M stand for?
Multiply.
And the D?
Divide.
And the A?
Addition.
And the S?
Subtract.
Okay, so far so good. Now, here's something very special. What do we know about this? We know we would do parentheses and then exponents, but if I have multiplication and division together, what order do I go in?
Right?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you. Did you say left to right?
Yes.
Okay, so the multiplication and division are done, whichever one comes first, in order from left to right.
Yeah.
All right, perfect. You're so smart, Deborah. Okay, now, for addition and subtraction, what do we do if they're together?
Left to right.
Left to right. Okay, so make sure that our audience knows what we're going to do, because you know what? I know you don't do this, but sometimes students will go, oh, the M comes first, so wherever the multiplication is, I have to always do it first. But that's not true. These are like a group. They're friends. And so whoever comes first, they go first. Okay?
Okay.
You're good?
Yes.
All right, so here we go. We're going to go back over here, and I'm going to use my black marker, and I'm going to highlight the operations. The raised dot means times. And you're familiar with the division sign, right?
Yeah.
Okay, now, Deborah, this is important. See these parentheses?
Yes.
They're not the same as the parentheses up here that stand for a grouping symbol.
Yeah.
Okay, now that's important because really the parentheses that we talk about could be any grouping symbol. So all this is doing is just holding that negative 6 there because math people, they don't like operations and negative signs side by side. So we say, okay, we'll just let it sit there, but it has to stay inside the little parentheses to hold it, okay?
Okay.
All right, so now let's get started. So we don't have any grouping symbols. Do we have any exponents?
No.
No. Do we have multiplication?
Yes.
And do we have division?
Yes.
So now we have to follow the red rule over here. What does it say? Go in order from what to what?
Left.
And we don't have addition and subtraction, so I'm not even going to go down that far. So let's go over here. We're going to start on the left and work to the right. So you tell me, what's negative 2 times 9?
Negative 18.
Good job, Deborah. I'm going to rewrite the rest of the problem for our viewers because sometimes when we do too much in our mind, we might miss a step. So all I've done is go from this step, rewriting the negative 6. So now all I have is one operation left to do, so this should be pretty easy for us. We have negative 18 divided by negative 6. So do you know the rule if you divide a negative by a negative, what kind of answer do you get?
A positive.
Okay, so what is the answer going to be?
Positive 3.
Positive 3. You are correct, Deborah, and thank you for helping me teach the other students watching about order of operations. That's helpful for all levels of students, and I appreciate you calling in and being an assistant teacher tonight on Math Homework Hotline.
Okay.
All right, have a really great night. Talk to you soon.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye, Deborah. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Bye.
Ah.
And now, Tammy, we're going to shift gears. We're going to go to our topic, an application tonight on our topic. And this is the best example you can encounter, in addition, of course, and after what Tammy would provide, but this is the best application as teachers. We encounter this a lot. Say we gave the tests for some students, and we did all the stats that we needed to do and figured out their percentiles. As we broke the data into percentiles or lined it up with the percentile concept. So we had some students with their reading scores and their math scores put as percentiles. Of course, for the percentile to be understood, it's not the same as percents. The difference between percentile and percent is the percent is very absolute. Means you got 100 questions, you did 70 right, lost credit for 30, so you're 70%. That's your score. But what 70 percentile means, it means that you are better performer than 70% of all the people that took that same test. That's what percentile means. Of course, the higher the better. Because those that have 90 percentile score would be performing better than 90% of the whole population of that class that took that same test or same exam. The lower, the not so good news, okay? That's the difference between percentiles and percentages. Some people don't really get that concept of percentile, but now I hope you do. So after we put the data in percentiles, let's take a look at my board and see how we have 10 students that we took their data and presented here. Let's take a look. This is, say, the math part. Here's the math. And this is the reading part. Right? The x-axis presents the math, and the y-axis represents the reading. And we're going to put a dot on this plot here, on this coordinate plane. Each dot would present the student. The student would have a math percentile score and a reading percentile score. All right? So for example, student 1 got 40 percentile in math and 30 percentile in reading. So this dot would present 40 and 30. The second student got 50 percentile in math and got 60 in reading. So we put a dot here. Third student got 50 in math and 80 in reading. Fourth one got 65 in math, 65 percentile in math, and 90 in reading. Third student got 70 in math and 40 in reading. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 so far. The next one, number 6 student, got 80 percentile in math and got 60 in reading. Next student got 90 percentile in math and 90 percentile in reading. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. We have three more to go. Next student got 85 percentile in math and got 70 in reading. Next student got 68 in percentile in math and 70 in reading. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. One more to go. The last one got 90 percentile in math and 99 in reading. Ladies and gentlemen, we want to look at these and try to read between lines. Is there a certain trend that we can relate to? I say, well, the more, let's see. 430 then went up to 50, 60, then went up to 50, 80, went up to 70, but lower here in 40. That's the exception here. 80 and 65, or 80 and 60, 90, and so on. You can see how if I have a solid line here to draw, I can draw a solid line here among most of these points like this, a line like this I would call the line of best fit, because it goes through the set of data presented on the graph, yet it's not going through all of them, of course, because these results are not linear. They are not all in one line. I would have called them linear, but they are scatter plot. This is what we call a scatter plot. They are scattered all over the place. Yet that blue line is fairly among most of them. It's hitting about three of them, which is not bad, having about four on one side of it, three on the other side of it. So to be fair to the whole set of data, I would say this fits best. We call it even the line of the best fit. They would give you several examples or several equations to choose from, which one would be the line of best fit. So you would have to find out the equation yourself here and then work it out and find which equation would you select to match that blue line. How would you find the equation of the best fit for the equation of the line of the best fit here? Remember, this point was order pair 40 and 30. This point here was order pair 90 and 90. 90 and 99. So here's 90 and 99. So take these two points and fly with them. Work your linear equation as usual, all right? The difference is in this situation, we just call it the line of the best fit. Has an equation? Yes, like any other line has an equation. What's the equation of this line that we call line of best fit? You would have to go find the slope first, which is y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. Let me label these for you. Here's X1, Y1, here's X2, and Y2. So you would basically go Y2, 99, minus Y1, which is 30, all over, X2, which is 90, minus X1, which is 40. Like any other two points in a plane, you find the equation of the line that passes through them or contains them. 99 minus 30, that is 69, divided by 90 minus 40, which is 50. That would be about, let's just take about 1.4. The slope is about 1.4. Take this slope and go with any of the points on the line, like this one, say. We're going to take this point and this line, this slope, sorry, and this point in particular, and find the equation of the line. How would you find the equation of the line? I'm going to make room here for myself. With this slope and this point, remember, we can say y minus y1 equals m times the quantity x minus x1. Y and x would remain y and x. Y1 is the 30. X1 is the 40. And m is the 1.4. So this would be then the equation of the line of best fit. If you would love to see this in the form of y equals mx plus b, no problem. You basically distribute this and then add 30 to both sides and make y by itself on one side, and you get it in the form of y equals mx plus b. Equation of the line of best fit of everybody. We hope that we understand now the percentile and what it means versus the percent. And double data. We have reading scores versus math scores. That's double data here. Back to you, Tammy.
All right. Thanks, Hannah. We're going to go ahead and take a look back a little bit about some of the information that's kind of the type of data that you're probably used to seeing. And remember, the topic of our show tonight is on bivariate data, which is similar to what Hannah just talked about. So let's take a look at where I was going to start before we had our caller call in. So let's go to univariate data, and you'll see on my board that basically when I look at this, it's data that is represented in one variable. Now, let me relate this to what Hannah just did, because what Hannah was doing was looking at two pieces, a math and a reading. In univariate data, it's one variable. This is the key part. And I'm going to help you out here. The prefix uni, just like unicorn, it has one horn coming out the top. Bivariate data always deals with two pieces, like bi meaning bicycle, with the two wheels. So the bivariate data will have two parts. So it's very easy to remember if you just look at your prefixes. But an example would be, and this happens a lot when you're first starting to learn about data and how to use it, is something like puppy weight. So let's say we have some puppies and we weigh them in pounds, and we just have the data. We have like 2.5, 3.5, 3.3, and 3.1 pounds. So we just have a list of data. Now, this is the type of data that would be used probably just to kind of describe what's happening. So basically in univariate data, you're just going to describe the data. And usually in this case, it does not deal with like a relationship or a cause. If we think about what Hannah just did, he related that the math and the reading kind of flowed together. Something happened, and we can look at students' math and data related to their reading. So you're looking at two different things. In univariate, all you're doing is describing what you see. Like for instance, I might be able to put this on a graph, and sometimes you'll see like a bar graph that'll show puppy weights for a long period of time. I could put it on maybe just a pie chart, anything I wanted to with the data, not necessarily the puppy weights, but any type of data that's univariate. You're just going to use maybe a histogram. You might even find the mean, median, or mode, but really you're just describing what you see. It's one variable. Another example might be if I was going to ask a question, And I would say, how many girls are in the eighth grade class? That's something that you could then collect data on, and you just have one piece of data, one variable involved. So that's univariate, and then we're gonna come back and we'll talk a little bit more about bivariate data and what that looks like as we're working through some problems through the rest of the show. So I'm gonna pass it back to Hannah, and I think he's gonna be looking at bivariate data.
Yes, ma'am. We have two sets of data. One here set of data like 5, 7, let's take a look at my board, everybody. 5, 7, 10, 15, and 25 say these are the set of points that one person scored in five different games. And on the other hand, we have another set of points that another person scored in those same five different games. We have here, say, 10, 12. And I meant to put them in order to ease the job and the mission on all of us. 17, 20, and 21. Now, we have a lot to go with here. We have this set of data and this set of data. If we wanted to compare them to one another, we have different tools to compare. I can find the mean here and the mean here and compare. And can find the median here to, and compare. All right? We don't rely much on the mode we used to have. We don't really have it anymore for the lack of its reliability. It's not very reliable. That's why we kind of like said, okay, mode, get on the side and sit and take a look at what we're doing. Means are reliable, medians are as well, but not the mode. All right, there are some other tools to be precisely comparing the data. Here and there, you can also find what we call the standard deviation and so on. You can find the sigma, which is a standard deviation for the first set of data, sigma or the standard deviation of the second set of data, and then compare standard deviation versus standard deviation. We're going to just take a quick look at what those tools are like. For example, if I wanted to compare mean to mean, I would have to go and add 5 plus 7 plus 10 plus 15 plus 25 and divide that by 5. At the same time, I would go there and add 10 plus 12 plus 17 plus 20 plus 21 and compare this, and divide that by 5 also. This is mean 1, M1, and M2. We can even write mean 1 and mean 2 instead of M, not to confuse it with the slope. Mean 1 equals this sum over 5, and mean 2 equals this sum over 5. The results of these means, whatever those results are, we're not worried about the results now. You know how to add and you know how to divide, so that's not a big... You have it ready for us?
Can
you please work it out? Thank you so much. This is one way of doing it, as to compare the data together. The other method to compare the data together is basically, can change colors here, and we can go median, median 1, and median 2. And medians are easy to look at the data and find right away. Median 1. Median 1, and I put them in order for this reason, this ascending order, 5, 7, 10, 15, 25. These are 5 pieces, one from front and one from the back, one from front and one from the back, ending with 10 being the median here. One from the front and one from the back, one from front and one from the back, 17 being the median there. You can easily compare and decide that this person's mean is higher than this person's mean, okay? Now, mean per game. See, he played 5 games. This is his average per game. This one also played the same 5 games, and this is his average for per game. You can tell how this player scored much higher versus this guy. What are the results, Tammy, for this?
Mean 1 is 12.4.
For this one, 12.4?
12.4.
Okay, sorry. Bad marker. Mm-hmm. 12.4, yes ma'am, thank you.
And mean 2 is 16.
16. All right. Again, look how things are very much lining up. 12.4 versus 16. You can tell that this person scored higher by comparing their means together. This person scored higher by comparing their medians together. Right now, I'm going to take you to the more precision, the more precise kind of tool, which we call the standard deviation. And for the standard deviation, we're going to use the mean here and the mean there. I'm going to find the standard deviation for this person, player one, and the standard deviation for player two. Because I want you to understand how do you work the standard deviation, just in case, as an experience, since we are doing data and stats and stuff, it's the right time to cover the standard deviation. All right, for the standard deviation, it's basically this. I need to go with the mean and go label this mean as x bar. Then I'm going to take it minus x1, and that is the 12.4 minus 5. Then go x bar, which is the 12.4, that's the mean, minus x2. So that's 12.4 minus x2, which is 7. And you know what? Sometimes we get bigger than the mean, so this is going to end with a negative. That's why we have it put always in absolute values, just for you to know. We're going to figure out all these calculations. Here's the mean, minus x3. And we're going to put these in absolute values as well, like this. And we continue to do this for all five of them, x bar minus x4, x bar minus x5. All of them are put in absolute values. So here you have absolute value of 12.4 minus 10. Absolute value of 12.4 minus 15. Absolute value of 12.4 minus 25. All right, we're going to work these out. Tammy, if you help us, please. 12.4 minus 5, I can do this mental math, 7.4, whose absolute value is 7.4 also. 12.4 minus 7 is, I can do this also, 5.4, whose absolute value is 5.4 as well. 12.4 minus 10 is absolute value of 2.4, with absolute value 2.4 also. Here, 12.4 minus 15 is absolute value of, is it negative 3.6, Tammy?
2.6.
Sorry. Negative 2.6, thank you, whose absolute value is 2.6. The last one is 12.4 minus 25, which I believe is going to be 12.6.
Negative
12.6, right? Absolute value of negative 12.6, everybody, is 12.6. I'm going to leave these to Tammy to add together, because we need all of these guys added together, and that's their sigma. Sorry, their summation. While Tammy is adding these together for us, kindly and gently, she's an amazing person, as you all know, we're going to work this one together. We're going to get the mean of these. Here's 16. And we're going to do the same process here. I'm going to get you this one finalized and then let you do this one on your own. All right, everybody? Then you can compare the standard deviation to the standard deviation. I'm going to go this way. But you know what you're going to do tonight. You're going to take this set of data and find exactly the same pattern of work, find the standard deviation the same way for this other set of data. What are we going to do here? We're going to take, this is what we call sigma, the standard deviation for this set. This is sigma 1, everybody, would equal. And we put big, gigantic square root. And we're going to add all of these together after we square them. We're going to take this square, Tammy. I'm sorry. Go ahead and square 7.4 for me. Plus 5.4, square also. Plus 2.4 squared plus 2.6 squared plus 12.6 squared. 12.6 also squared. All of that divide by n, which is how many they are, and they are 5. And that square root would generate our standard deviation. So we're adding them together. We have big numbers resulting. As you square this, you square this, you square this, you square this, you square that. Add all those squares together. Divide by 5. Tammy is working so hard. I really thank you, Tammy, for that.
Those are the squared numbers.
The squared numbers. Can we then, we have now, just for you to know, if you want it on the record to be there in your hands, it's 54.76, 29.16, 5.76, 6.76, and 158.76. Their total is 5, and then take the square root of this result. Of course, you understand if there are some errors here, please give us some room. We're rushing and doing it on air is not an easy task.
255.2.
255.2. And you guys know we know how to do math very well, but if there is an error in the calculation, please give us some big hearts. I know you have big hearts and you understand. Now we're going to divide this by 5, Tammy.
127.6.
So that would be the square root of 127.6, which is about equal?
11.3.
About equal to 11.3. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the standard deviation for player 1. You're going to do the same exact thing for player 2, and then you can compare. This is described to be one of the most precise comparison tools between any two sets of data, standard deviation. All right, everybody, hope you enjoyed learning the mean comparison versus median comparison and the most precise, which is the standard deviation comparison. Back to you, Tammy.
Thanks, Hannah. Actually, I'm going to go ahead and cue you to get ready because I'm going to have the honor of giving out some t-shirts to our t-shirt winners, but you need to get ready for the challenge question because I think we might have a winner.
Oh, that's good news.
Get ready. Right. Okay, my t-shirt winner so far tonight, remember, it's the Do the Math shirt. It does get sent out to your math teacher at your school site, so it takes a couple of days, but let your math teacher know that you won so they can keep an eye out for it. The first one's going to go to a student at Williams, so congratulations to Ayana. I think I said that correctly. It's spelled like Ayana, I think. Hopefully I got it right. Congratulations to you out at Williams. And our second one goes to a student out at Lutz Prep. So congratulations to Grace out at Lutz Prep. Very excited that you will be walking around with your Do the Math shirt. I love mine. I wear it often, and hopefully you will too. All right, and I hear that we did get a challenge question winner, and I want to see who it is. They're going to show us in just a minute. I'm so excited. It's a student from Williams, Hannah.
All right, let's see here. Hello?
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good.
Welcome to Math Homework Hotline. We're honored to have you with us. Would you please introduce yourself to everybody?
My name is Juliana Field.
Say the name again.
Juliana Field.
All right. We hope that you would always call Math Homework Hotline and enjoy it and tell people about it. All right? Go ahead and tell me, what is your final answer?
My final answer is 106,666.6 repeating.
Which I can round to 7, right?
Yes.
0.7. And that is what, dollars?
No.
Tell me what the unit you have. Think it again. We're talking volume. You mean cubic foot?
Yes, cubic.
All right. For volume, we always use with cubic units. All right?
Yes.
And here we have the pyramid, as you can see it from the side. We have the height here. I'm going to change colors. And here's the height from the vertex to the center of the base. Here's H. And here's the edge of one, or the length of this one side of the square, which is, we're told, is 80.
50 feet, right? 50.
No, the edge here is 80. The height is 50.
Oh.
The height is 50 foot. And the length of each side of the square is 80 foot. If we work it together, you'll find your answer done the right way because of these. These are the data that we gave you. Let's work it together. What's the formula you used for the volume of the pyramid?
The volume of the pyramid is 1/3
mm-hmm.
times the base square times the height.
Right. So it's 1/3 times the area of the base, whatever that base is, times the height, and that's the volume of any pyramid, right?
Yes.
What kind of base we have?
We have a square base.
Correct. And what's the area of the square?
The area of the square base
mm-hmm.
is...
When you have a square with length of side 80 foot, don't you multiply length of side times itself?
I'm sorry, I cannot hear you.
When you have a square like this, with a length of side 80, as you look at the square as any rectangle, and you say length of side times length of side, or base times height, or length times width, however you call them, or basically we say side square. Only for a square, we have this privilege to say the area of the square is side square. You see that?
Yes.
So that would be 80 squared. That's the area of the mm-hmm. square. You follow?
Yes, I follow.
Go ahead. Multiply this by the height, which is?
Okay, so
50,
80
right?
squared
uh-huh.
by the height.
80 squared 80. Is 80 squared times the height. 80 squared, that's the area of the square base, times the height, which is 50, and we take 1/3 of that.
320,000.
Here is 1/3 times, if you square the 80, you get 6400, am I right?
Mm-hmm.
And times that by 50, and if you square 6400 times 50, I have it here. You do it with me. 6400 times this by 50, you get 320,000. That's 320,000, right? You're going to multiply this by 1/3. 1/3 times this means you take that, and you, as it is on your calculator, you divide it by 3. And that would equal the
it
one.
Would equal it would equal 100,000.
106,000.
Yes.
666.
106,000.
Mm-hmm.
666.6 repeating.
Right, which is 0.7 rounded to the nearest tenth cubic foot. I tell you what, you made it. And you are the winner for our challenge question tonight. I am very, very proud of you. Keep up the good work and tell everyone at Williams that you made it. And you wear your T-shirt that will get to you in the mail proudly. And just be a good teller. Tell everybody about our program and how good it is. If you think it is good. Do you think it is good?
Yes.
You benefit of it?
Hmm?
Do you benefit of it?
Yes, I do benefit.
How often do you watch it?
I watch Math Homework Hotline pretty often.
Very often. We're very proud that you watch. Keep watching and keep learning and keep prospering. We're very proud of you and wish you the best wishes. Good night.
Good night.
Bye. Back to you, Tammy.
All right. right, thanks. They let me know we might have a caller calling in with a question, so I'm going to go ahead and get started. I'm not sure if we have the caller on air yet. I think if we do, they'll join us in just a moment. But the problem that they've called in about is about finding the sum. Maybe we have you. Nixley, are you on the line?
Yes.
Hi, how are you tonight?
Good.
Can you see your TV from where you are?
Yeah.
Okay, wonderful. Because they're going to put the board up in just a moment, and I'm going to work through the problem with you, so I wanted to make sure you could see it. So thanks for calling in, and there's the board. So the question that they told me you had was to find the sum without a number line. So I think Ms. Fry wants you to do this problem without using a number line and no calculator, I'm guessing, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this problem, and I worked with probably one of your classmates a little earlier about some integer problems, but this one, when I look at it, there's all addition signs. So I'm adding things together, but this time I'm adding things that are positive and I have some things that are negative. So this would be something like in a situation where you had money, like if I had $2.75 and then I let Hannah have $2 and then I let him have another $5.25, I think something bad might happen. So we're going to see what happens if I try to give him more money out of my checking account, because I don't think I have enough. So let's see what happens. So I don't know what you've done, so tell me what you think you might do. I know how I would start this problem, but tell me how you think you would start it.
Well, we would start by adding the two negatives.
Very nice. I like that strategy, and I use that same one myself because I look to see what signs I have. This one's positive, but I notice that I have two that are negative. Now, you don't have to do it that way. You could start from left to right and work through because it's all addition. But in this case, I have the two negatives. So I want to go ahead and combine those together. So let's go ahead and pull that out. Is it Nixley? Am I saying it right?
Yeah.
Okay, so I have negative 2 plus the negative 5.25. Now, we're going to do a little bit of mental math here. Do you know what the answer to that is? Just this part.
Just that would be 7.25.
Yes, but what would the sign be? Because they're both negative, so what would the sign be of this part?
Addition?
The sign on the number.
Oh, they'd be positive.
Well, let's think about it, because it would be positive if you were multiplying, but we're not multiplying. What we're doing here is we're just adding negatives. So I'm going to come over here and I'm going to do a little thought bubble with you. So here we go. See my little thought bubble?
Yes.
All right. So let's pretend that you and I have gone to the beach and we have a bucket. And we got some sand, okay? So we're getting ready to build something, and we start digging. And we dig down 5.25 feet, really far, right? That's actually like almost as tall as I am. And then I say, wait a minute, let's take a break. And then we come back and we dig down another 2 feet. How far down have we gone?
-7.25.
Good job. It is going to be negative because we're still going down. Now think about money. If I owed Hannah $2 and then I owe him $5 more, I'm going to be in the negative because I owe him money. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay. So now we have 2.75 that we haven't done anything with plus this negative 7.25. Now before we even do the problem, I want to help you with some mental math things. I have negative 7.25, so I have a negative 7.25 and a positive 2.5. Which do I have more of? Negatives? Yeah. So in this case, I have to think about it, because if I was thinking about my sand and I got down here to negative 7.25 and then I started filling it back up, am I ever going to fill it up enough to get back to the top with 2.75?
No.
So I'm going to still be in the negative. Or think about it, like if I owe Hannah money, I always owe Hannah money on this show. I don't know why. But if I owe him $7.25 and I come to the show next week and I go, here, Hannah, I have $2.75, I still am going to owe him money. So we would just then need to work this out. And you can either do it with mental math or you can write it out. And I believe the answer is going to be 4.5.
My teacher taught us to make it into absolute value.
Okay, so they tell you to take the difference and then get the final answer?
Mm-hmm.
Right, you take the difference of the two, and then the answer is the sign of the larger one without reference to the sign. So when I get 4.5, am I now going to leave it as positive or make it negative?
Make it negative.
Good job. Great job, Nixley. You did a wonderful job, and I think we're done.
Miss Tammy.
Yes, I have a new last name, so it's probably very confusing, isn't it? Did you come to the studio the day that we did the walkthrough here?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So my name at that time was Miss Rush, you're right, and my new name is Mrs. Derry. So I got married since the last time I saw you. All right. Have a really good night, and thanks for calling in. I'm getting ready to give away some stuff, so I'll talk to you soon, Nixley. Have a good night.
You too. Thank you.
All right. And Hannah, it's that time for me to give away some gift cards.
Some people are lucky tonight.
I get to do the fun stuff. And they are lucky because they are getting gift cards to McDonald's. So I have to admit, I do love their french fries. So here we go. Gift cards. First student is at Barrington. Anna Marie, congratulations. And those gift cards, as with t-shirts, are sent out to your math teachers, and they will provide you with a gift card when it gets there. And from Davidson Marcus, so congratulations to you. And another winner, last one for tonight for the McDonald's gift cards, goes to Jennings Middle School. Student name is Maria. All right, congratulations, Maria Marcus and Anna Marie. All right, Hannah, I'm sending it back to you.
Sure, Tammy, thank you so much. I'm here ready to take it. And here, everybody, we're going to share with you the box plot as another tool to compare the two sets of data. But we don't have the time to do two box plots. We're going to just do one, and you do the other one. If you have another set of data, you know how to, like I asked you to do the other standard deviation. We can do this also. If I have another set of data, I can leave it up to you, and you do that box plot yourself. Learn how to do one, and then go to your book, find any set of data, and establish the box plot for it also. All right, everybody? Let's take a look. I'm gonna rush a little bit because of the time. We have only a few minutes left in the program, but we're gonna see how we can make it as easy as possible and as clear as we can. We have a set of data that has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And that's good news. You know why? You say, why would 11 be good news? I say, well, odd number of data would always have a median that is easy to spot. One from the front and one from the back. Same, 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 same. And all of a sudden, 30 proved to be the median. For 30 being the median, I'm going to go on my number line and build the middle wall of this box plot. Here it is. I'm going to do it by hand. Here's the middle wall. All right. Thank you, 30. You helped us building the middle wall. At the same time, you broke this data into two parts, two halves. Go to the lower half, everybody. It goes from 3 to 28. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. See? Now, go ahead and find their what? Their median. Their median. That's 1, 1, 1, 1. 11 is the winner. Median of the lower half. So we go to 11, which is 10 here, 11 is here, and build the first wall, and then we have the last wall. Here we go. How would you go to build the last wall? We're gonna go to the upper half of the data and find their median, 1, 1, 1, 1. 44 is the winner. 44 is where we build the second wall or the last wall. All the walls would have the same height, and here is the box. All right, everybody? It goes from this wall here, which we call lower quartile, to this wall here, which we call upper quartile, where this 30 is the median of the whole data. So we have three medians, actually. We were so generous with medians tonight. We have a median for the whole data, and that's where we build this one. Not in the middle, I cannot call it middle, but it's the one in between the two other walls. This wall is the lower quartile, and that's the median of the lower half. See, lower half, median. Then the UK, which is the upper quartile, that's the median of the upper half. So here's the upper half, 44 was the winner. Now, we have then to extend two lines here, or line segments, that would go from the smallest piece of data, which is 3. Here's 0, here's 5. 3 is usually here. Here is 3. And the last one, which is the maximum value, which is 50. Here is 50, here is 50. You then do this and do this. We used to call these whiskers, but we don't anymore. I didn't say whiskers. If you heard it, I didn't say it. Somebody else did it. All right. We call this a box plot instead of, it used to be called box and whisker. And they thought, well, middle school kids are big kids. They don't need to call it whiskers. So we call it box plot. Big name for big kids. All right, everybody? This is the box plot. Now, what is it beneficial for? What do we use it for? Here, from 3 all the way to 11, believe it or not, you have 1/4 of the data. From here to here, you have 1/4 of the data. Then, from here to here, you have 1/4 of the data. From here to here, you have 1/4 of the data. From here to here, you have 1/4 of the data also. This is how it breaks down. It breaks to 4 quartiles. This is the lower quartile. This is the higher quartile. You can compare the lower quartile here to the lower quartile in the other set, higher quartile to the higher quartile in the other set. And most of the data exists in this half here between the two LK and the UK, the lower quartile and the UK, which is the upper quartile. And by the way, if you subtracted 44, which is the upper quartile, took away 11, which is the lower quartile, you get 33. You know what this 33 is called? It's called the inner quartile range, the IQR, inner quartile range, everybody. That's the 33, which is the difference between these two quartiles. The very lower case, which is 3, the very higher case, which is 50, the difference between them would be the 47, which is basically the range of the whole set of data. So there is a range, and there is interquartile range, or so, IQR, everybody. We have to wrap it up. We're about out of time, but we hope you enjoyed the hour with us. We enjoy being with you. Oh, we have a call. Oh, T-shirts?
We have some more T-shirts to give away.
I'm so sorry.
I know. I'm so excited. I was getting ready to interrupt you, and I was going to say, hey, look. Okay, here we go. Before we leave the show, we are going to give away 3 more T-shirts. I hope you're still watching from Burns. Jamaeus, congratulations. I'm so excited for you. And from Sly Middle School, and the Do the Math shirt's coming out to you. It looks just like this. To Devante, congratulations. And out at Progress Village, yes, T-shirts coming to you, Beyonce. So congratulations. And to all
there's
of
them. There's one more.
There, I think
Hannah from Alonzo. Alonzo
Hannah,
High School.
Hannah, you already have one. All right.
I wear it very proudly.
Good. Congratulations to all of our winners tonight of the McDonald's gift cards, the T-shirts, and our challenge question winner tonight. And don't forget to keep watching. Next week, we will be drawing for our final Kindle. Hannah,
and
wrap
next,
it up.
Next week is going to be a big show. We're going to review for the 8th graders algebra EOC. So if you are in 8th grade, if you know somebody in 8th grade wanting to do well on the EOC, you know what to do. Turn on the Tampa Education channel or get online and watch us live. We'll be happy to assist you with any of your questions. Go Math Homework Hotline. We're very proud of you all. We love you all. We'd wait forward. We look forward to working with you next time. Have a great night, everyone.
Good night, everyone.